destroyed because of this freak. I won't allow it!
These babies just saved this lame fest party!
Guys, what's going on? You are listening to ThisWeekinGeek.net, and I am your host for this season, or many seasons, or all of them, more or less. I am Mike the Birdman, but I'm not alone as we trek down this, well, kind of a different season opener than what we were originally expecting this year. This is my co-host, my best friend, my brother, hetero life mate, and just all-around good guy who fixes stuff when shit breaks around here.
Alex, the producer, I was going to see how long can he keep going with the titles.
See, I remember I did a show with Dave and I gave him like 30 different titles. He's like, holy shit. I'm like, yeah, don't worry. I could probably make it up if you give me like 3 seconds to think. But yeah, guys, so welcome back to the fall season of This Week in Geek. We have more or less come back from our summer hiatus. We are going to be doing more shows in the interim. You're going to get more Loose Cannons, Future Imperfects, our annual Halloween special. We're just getting the details ironed out with that right now. And we're just going to be doing a lot more fun content for you guys as we proceed towards the sprint, which is the holiday gift guide, which airs usually around the second week of December. And then we go into the Odin sleep until just after Magfest in January. However, that being said, this season opener is going to be a little bit different. And mostly because life has decided to punch Alex and I in the face. To give you a brief idea on last time on Birdman's Life, this week alone, I have been attacked by a dog. I got attacked by a pit bull Great Dane mix here in Guelph. Fortunately, I wasn't too badly injured. It didn't break the skin, but I did veer off course. I got stuck in my wheelchair in some gravel. Unfortunately, the police had to get involved because, you know, what if this was somebody else? What if this was a kid or something? So hopefully the local police have dealt with this and this owner realizes maybe you should have a muzzle on this animal. So that happened and that freaked me right out. And then I went to the movies on Thursday night. I went to go see the 30th anniversary of Ninja Scroll, which I didn't realize the movie was that old. And it had been so long since I seen Ninja Scroll. I remember renting this movie on VHS in high school from Blockbuster.
Well, so it was one of the four Japanimation movies that were in every single store. It was
Michelle.
I'm talking before that, even before Ghost in the Shell, like the late 80s, early 90s staples. I guess you could, okay, if they didn't have one of the freaking borderline hentai things like Demon City, whatever it was called, or
Wicked City
or Demon Shizuku, whatever it was called. If they didn't have those there and they put those in the adult section, they would have Ghost of the Shell in that place. But it was basically then Ghost of the Shell, Ninja Scroll, Akira, and what's the fourth one? Vampire Hunter D.
All of which are awesome movies.
But those are like, that was the Japanimation section, was those mixed in with random episodes of Ranma, Record of Lodoss War, Bubblegum Crisis, and
Ava.
Ava a little later, yeah, Ava. And then you'd have like just a crap ton of Pokemon and stuff, and they'd have that mix in the section. And if you were really lucky and you went to a store that really didn't know about separating stuff, they would have Ninja Scroll like right next to episodes that you could rent of like Power Rangers and Ninja Turtles, because they thought all cartoons were for kids.
Oh yeah, it was wild. So I went to go see this on Thursday night. had an amazing time because I've seen very few anime on the big screen. And this, they had a like 30-minute interview with the director of Ninja Scroll, who actually directed Wicked City
which I think I've told you off air. A coworker of mine who's about 10 years older than me, but a coworker of mine took his girlfriend, who then became his wife, to go see that movie in theaters as the date, one of their first dates. I was like, you're going to see Wicked City? He goes, yeah, she liked it. I'm like, wow. He goes, yeah, she was a keeper.
Yeah, clearly. So we saw this, and it had been so long, I didn't remember anything outside of the clips you see online with the big dude who turns into rock with his throwing sword, the chick with the gunpowder, the naked girl with the snakes and everything. And I forgot just how cool this movie was and how it moved. And it was funny, the director was talking about how he was inspired by people like John McTiernan from Die Hard. He was talking about Predator and all this shit. It was amazing just to hear all of his inspirations for shit.
And at that point, when that movie came out, I think Golgo 13 and a couple of the other ones had English releases here. Mm-hmm. But like, if I remember, one of the big deals with Ninja Scroll wasn't just that it was mature and blah, 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 was that it was one of the first good dubs.
Mm-hmm.
Like not, and a good dub in the 80s and 90s is not like a good dub now. A good dub now is like really good. But like, you know what I mean? Like there were, you could count on one hand how many shows had or movies had a really good English dub. And it was, and that's why it was like perpetually rented in every store, right? Because it was more like a Western production. It didn't feel like a really cheap production.
Yeah, like it was.
Did you see it in English, or was it in?
Yeah, it was in English. Although, the next movie I'm going to go see in October is the original Gundam movie in Japanese, and I've seen one movie in theaters subtitled, but I can't remember what it was for the bloody life of me. But I'm really looking for it. It's cool. Like, our local theater is evidently doing this once a week until at least March. They're showing a new Gundam movie each month.
Oh, wow.
Holy shit, that's fucking cool.
Be prepared to be annoyed, though, for that movie. You're just going to hear Amuro, Amuro, Amuro over and over again from that little robot.
Oh yeah. It's going to get real grating real fast. So I go see this movie, have a fantastic time. I bring home dinner along the way because it's like midnight by the time we get out. So I just stop by a McDonald's and grab something quick. So I go home, I eat my dinner, I'm working on some stuff for the podcast, and I start to feel really, really sick. My wife had assumed food poisoning, same here. So I was really sick all night. I was shivering, shaking, not looking good. I had like a fever of like 102. We call my sister, who's a nurse practitioner. We show her some pictures of me, and she's like, you need to go to the ER right now. So we're thinking, well, that's not good news to hear. So we go into the ER, and they diagnose me. I'm in there like 7 hours, and it turns out I have cellulitis. Now, this is not the first time I've had this. I've had this a couple times before, I lost my leg.
It's a bacterial infection of the skin where skin has broken or had a cut or something, usually.
Yeah, so this had come in a really unusual place. It was on my like lower stomach, and we're like, okay, that's weird. So I went into the ER. They examined me in a few places where the infection could have got in. It didn't get in the traditional way that we thought it might have, so thank God for that. But they're like, okay, we're going to give you IV antibiotics, and we're going to give you a blood culture. So what they do is they took this giant thing of blood with this serum, and they were going to grow and look for certain infections in me, see if a certain bacteria had grown. Now, that was a couple days ago. I haven't heard from the hospital, so that's a very positive sign that I probably don't have any bacterial infection of the blood. But I had to go back on Saturday morning to get another round of IV antibiotics. And luckily, I got in and out of there pretty quick. So I'm like, hey, I'm just here for another infusion. Just get me in, get me out. So I was in and out of there in like 3 hours and got that done. And the IV antibiotics, they kind of wiped me out. Like, I'm more tired than I thought I would be. And so that sucked. So I literally, just before Alex and I started recording the podcast today, I had a nurse come over to my house. She showed Blair how to do my IV antibiotics. So now Blair can be Nurse Blair for the next couple of days. I go back in for reassessment on Wednesday morning, where they're going to assume, are we going to need to do more IVs? Are we going to have to admit you, or can we just put you on oral? Likely they're just going to put me on oral antibiotics for a week, maybe one more flush and I should be good. But it's going to take me like a week and a half to recover from this, and it's just friggin' wild. But the positive thing to come out of this entire week is me and Liam got a chance to go to the early fan screening of Transformers 1. And I'll give you a very brief, no spoilers review of the movie. I would say I like the voice performances a lot. I don't think Chris Hemsworth is a terrible Optimus Prime. The guy who plays D-16 or Megatron, the guy that played Lemon from Bullet Train, is an amazing Megatron. I really like him. A lot of really cool background characters that are named characters later on. I know it's been announced on Twitter, the guy who plays Jazz again, nice to see him there, and really good score. The song that was released for the movie, yeah, it's not the Touch or Dare or Linkin Park, but it's pretty good. I thoroughly enjoy it. A lot of deep pulls from the IDW continuity and like other continuities, which I thought was kind of cool. I think it'll be very interesting to see if this continuity continues and they go elsewhere in this world, but I really did enjoy it. I'd say for me, it was a solid 7.5 to maybe an 8 out of 10, because I want to be critical with it. I can't just say, oh my God, is Optimus Prime, give it to me now. I have to be critical.
My question, or okay, the only thing I don't like about it, I haven't seen it yet. I was supposed to see it, but I'll say this. I did not have the health maladies that you went through, but I did have, I had a pretty bad sinus infection earlier in the week and like flu like symptoms. And I was like, oh man, do I have COVID? And I still had some testers here that, or test kits that weren't expired. And I tried to, no COVID, just the regular flu. And then I saw in the news that the flu came early this year to the region. So that's probably what I had. And it just made me lethargic. So I couldn't do anything. So I wasn't able to go. I had the ticket for it and then they canceled it. There was a whole debacle on their end. Because there was an issue with how the ticket was redeemed. Not my problem, their problem. So I ended up coming out on top. But I was on the fence about it because of one simple thing. I don't care. Well, okay, I would like them to use the original voice actors because they're in their 70s and almost 80 or whatever. And they, you know, how much longer are we going to have, you know, Optimus and Megatron still able to do the voice?
I think there was Frank Welker in it. I would almost be positive.
But you know what I mean? Like, they're getting up there. I was getting worried. But my biggest concern is not that they have voice actors. It's that, in, at least in the trailers, none of them used, like, a robotic vocoder sound effect above their voices. So it just sounds like humans talking through a robot.
Yeah, it does get a little bit better towards the end. I can say that.
But you know what I mean? Like, why wouldn't they just do the Transformer vocal effect on top of them?
Yeah, I'm not 100% sure on that one. I mean, I really couldn't give you a clear and concise answer about that.
I don't just mean like sound wave, you know, like that. But you know how like they always put like a synth effect above their voice to give it sort of a animatronic sound? Mm-hmm. And they didn't see, like, it sounds odd that you just hear a pure, clean, like, human voice through the robot without it sounding processed. But that's just a nitpick on my end. I'll know for sure how I feel once I actually watch the whole thing.
Yeah, for sure. But yeah, I mean, overall, I think it's a rather enjoyable movie. I think it's going to do well in theaters, as I don't think there's a lot of strong competition this month. There's another movie that was advertised I really want to see called The Wild Robot, which I think looks really cool. It's from DreamWorks. It looks like a robot raises a goose and they've got a fox friend, and it looks kind of neat. So I'm like, always into that sort of thing.
It's not the same, but is it not giving you a little bit of like Iron Giant vibes?
Kind of. It looks fun. So I hope it's good. I hope it's as moving as I think it has the capacity to be. And so that's pretty much been my week. Well,
I'll say this for that Wild Robot. The reason it probably looks charming to you is it's got some Disney alum working on it. The director is the guy that directed and wrote Lilo and Stitch.
Oh, that's cool.
As well, and he also directed and wrote How to Train Your Dragon 1.
Oh, neat.
So it, you know what I mean? It does have somebody who knows how to make a good family movie
in charge. Mm-hmm. Chris
Sanders, I think, is the director.
Oh, Okay. So yeah, as a result, this show is going to be a little bit different. We're going to be doing, this is mostly going to be a review show, which is fine. We do have some obligations to keep to some of our wonderful friends out there. Plus, we wanted to make sure you guys knew what was kind of going on with the thing and just whatnot. But we are committed to coming back next week, providing neither Alex or I die. Knock on wood. Fucking wood.
Yes.
Let's not die.
Let's just be very clear. I don't want bad things to happen to either of us, even if it's accidentally or through act of stupidity.
Yeah, exactly. So coming up from me in this show, you're going to be hearing a pair of reviews from Warner Brothers Home Entertainment. I'll be talking about Succession, the complete series, this time on Blu-ray. And I'm also going to be taking a look at Vikings Valhalla, the complete first season. And then finally, we're going to be taking a look at my initial thoughts on the 2024 edition of the Dungeons & Dragons Player's Handbook. We're going to be talking about that in a little bit of detail. I have not had a chance to put this into playtest. I just don't have a group who wants to give this a spin right now. I'm sure that'll change. And then finally, I'm going to be looking at my first Titan class Transformer of this year. Hasbro was kind enough to send over Transformers Legacy United Tidal Wave from Armada and his Dark Fleet. Really looking forward to be chatting about that. So those are going to be the four reviews you're going to hear from me. Alex, what has been going on with you and what's going to be coming up from you in this show?
I have had a lot. there was that. I know we go through these lulls, and every time I notice, I'll be like, "Hey, we've got nothing to review, or almost nothing." You know, we try to keep the pipeline full, and then we'll get a period where they've got nothing, and then I'll get like six things at once, and I'll be like, "Oh, I could do six things," and then it turns out they're all larger projects, and it's like, "Oh no!" So at the same time that we got the Final Fantasy VII that we discussed, you know, earlier, I also received Visions of Mana, which will be a review in here, which is another 30-40 hour, depending on how you play RPG. I have Emio, the Smiling Man. That's the Famicom Detective Club game from Nintendo. So that I'll have a review of that in here as well. I have a review of some computer stuff. Weirdly enough, a review of some thermal compound and thermal devices that you can use to keep your CPU and your computer running pretty cool, because I've got some projects in the works coming up for upgrades to my studio hardware / reviewing rigs and that. And eventually, after I'm done mine, we'll have to see about upgrading your stuff eventually too, because our stuff's getting a little long in the tooth. 5 years now. Hard to believe we bought our computers 5 years ago.
Oh, Jesus.
But it, you know, they're still good 1080p machines, but the reality is we need to start moving into 1440p for any computerized stuff. You might think 4K, but let's be real, most game consoles are actually only running 1440p, and then they just like upscale to 4K. So it's just we're approaching the point where for a company like us that puts out a lot of reviews, we're like 90% console, but we still need to be able to do some PC related stuff. Plus, we're, you know, it's probably starting to age out. We're going to have to do an upgrade to Windows 11 for you next year when Windows 10 gets shut down. I've already been on Windows 11, but so there's some projects in the works there when it comes to upgrading things. And I've got the process started on my end. So I'll have some reviews, at least one in here of some of the hardware that I'm putting in, because some stuff was provided for that. I'll have some movies. I'm not sure exactly which ones, but 88 Films has sent over stuff before, and they've sent a bunch of stuff. That is one of the companies that puts out a lot of Hong Kong pictures, and you know, whether it be kung fu, action, drama. So I've got some stuff that just arrived that might make it into this episode. If not this, it'll be in the next. I also have a Demon Slayer Mario Party-esque game that'll be, the review will be in this show. And then coming in, not right now, but coming next week, I'll have a review. You know, it's a little late, but we got it the day of release, so it doesn't, I can't blame me for that, of the Star Wars what was it, Rebels,
Outlaws,
that's it, goddamn. But that came the day of release, so you know, and that's a longer game too. It's like 30-40 hours to go through everything. And then On top of that, I also have a review coming of Astrobot, which again, we got day of release at the same time that we got Star Wars and the same time that I got Visions of Mania and at the same time, you know what I mean? Like these things all added up and it's like, sometimes you get lucky and you get the games a couple weeks before their release. So you have time to sort of schedule and get things ready for their release. Sometimes they come to you all on the same day of the release of all the games. And it's like, oh no. So we'll have some of that coming. And then I've got a few other projects in the works that are going to be embargoed until some smaller, some larger, until the middle of October, even in some cases. So I do have some stuff early that we'll be talking about. I can say one of the things I've received, because I believe the game is out as of this recording, is I got the Funko game.
Oh, cool.
Which is interesting because, you know, people rag on it. We've ragged on it, like Funko, but, you know, all the trailers we saw were for like the Nintendo Switch and they look kind of rough. Well, the Switch game isn't even out yet. It's just the like bigger consoles. And, you know, I've got it. I received it. I'm starting to work on the review for that. I can't necessarily talk about it yet because I haven't had a chance to fully dig in because I was finishing up this stuff. But I'll say this. It's like 53 gigs. And I'm like, that's pretty darn big for a Funko game. So I'm
that's surprisingly huge.
I'm going to dig in. I think it's going to have... it says there's a lot of music involved that is like not cleared for use on streaming, which, you know, luckily we're not streaming that game in particular. I'm a feeling it's going to be a lot of licensed use from like movies and stuff. And I'm like, oh, that's cool. So that'll take up some space. I'm going to assume the graphics are probably better than I'm going to expect because, again, every trailer we saw was like a YouTube encoded trailer that showed off like the Switch version. You know what I mean? Like it looked rough. Mm-hmm. But so I was expecting the game to be like, what, 8, 15 gigs, 53? It's like there's got to be something to it. So that'll be coverage on that coming out whenever, in due time, basically, right? So we've got that and a bunch of other stuff that I've got in the pipeline. And then, of course, we have plenty more we can talk about in the outro of what's coming up specifically to programming. But yeah, that's pretty much it. I've been inundated with reviews. I'm happy to do it, but we'll see. Some of the stuff has to be spaced out a little bit here.
Yeah. So, and I guess one final thing to mention for me, I also did receive the new Castlevania collection. I was able to receive that on the PlayStation 5. And initial thoughts, ooh. So I will have a review of that coming up sometime in the next week or so, plus some other RPG book content as well. So without any further ado, we're going to throw it to Alex and me doing alternating reviews here on the show, and then we'll come back again at the intro to kind of give you guys a preview on what's going to be coming up on the upcoming season here on thisweekingeek.net. So without any further ado, I'm going to throw it over to, well, one of us. We'll be back, guys, right after this, only on thisweekingeek.net.
Our friends over at 88 Films have sent a few releases over the last week or so, and this is going to be sort of a September roundup for some Shaw Brothers classics on Blu-ray for either the first time or at least the first time to us. And we've talked about some other 88 Films releases over the last few months or so, and these are in the new 88 Films Asia collection. Numbered 38, 41, and 42. There's The Golden Lotus, The Shadow Boxing, and then To Kill a Mastermind. These are classics from the golden era of Shaw Brothers / Hong Kong films back in the 70s, as well as just from a bygone era of Hong Kong filmmaking, right? Everything changed in the late 90s with the handover back to the mainland China, and the 80s had the big dramatic changes with John Woo and the contemporary directors and actors popping up. But this is from back in the era when pretty much everything was a historical piece with Kung Fu and everything involved. And without going into too much detail of the film plots, occasionally they would delve, you know, into more, I guess, genre specific and sometimes even erotica. There's a little bit of that involved in some of these pictures, but for the most part, if you've seen a Shaw Brothers classic, you sort of understand what you're getting with in these. Also, I'll say this, if you like, you know, the classic Shaw Brothers historical kung fu chop sake epic stuff, then you're going to like most of these to begin with. You don't even need the plots directly, because I don't want to spoil it too much, but you're probably coming to this to wonder whether or not they're going to be worth picking up if you've seen them previously, or if you're new to it, what's the transfers like? Well, I can say this. They've done a really good job. Transfers are all clean. They look pristine from brand new transfers for sure. They're all in the 2:3:5 scope aspect ratio. So they haven't done anything to mess with the original theatrical presentation. They're all mono audio, as most Hong Kong pictures were up until the late 90s. And they are at least completely uncompressed. They are in WAV PCM format. So they'll run on any player. You don't need like a special DTX decoder or anything like that to make them run. It'll run on anything. Fully English subtitled on each. They're all in Mandarin, as was sort of the standard at the time. They all have slipcase covers, which are actually really nicely done with new artwork. There is collectible art cards in the... I may as well go them individually here, so you know. The Golden Lotus has some art cards inside of it. There's a brand new original negative transfer, like I mentioned on here. There is the trailer for it, the initial trailer that they would have shown over there. There's some stills gallery and a reversible sleeve that you can put inside that, you know, has like the original poster artwork and then the newly created stuff. As for the release for To Kill a Mastermind, this one has the same thing, slip cover, the art cards, the original, the new transfer. It also has stills gallery, and it's pretty much the same on that one. And then as we go into the final release here, which is Shadow Boxing, this one, art cards as well. There is... everything is pretty much the same standard list, but what's interesting I wanted to mention is these are all region AB. So if you're region C, I guess you won't be able to see them, but these are coded for Europe and North America. The discs were all printed or pressed in Poland and brought out here. They're well mastered. There's no mastering issues. It plays on any player. I've popped it in, obviously being region A and B, so you shouldn't have any trouble unless you're outside of those regions, or if you have a region free player, obviously no issues. Audio quality is varying on each release. For the most part, it's the best quality you're gonna get from using the original optical tracks. The noted thing for most Hong Kong pictures was they never really filmed movies with audio, you know, on location, because it's just so noisy where they were that they didn't have the ability. So everything was always done in the studio after the fact, 80 yard in. It's just that they had varying degrees of quality of that. It was, you know, usually the vocals were a little more muddy. It's about as clean as you're going to get without doing a complete re-recording of everything. And for that, I'm happy, because it's better than what you would have had on VHS or DVD, especially the fact that you have no issues with any compression because it's completely uncompressed audio. Video wise, much more impressive. Very well done. Holds up today. There's something charming about these pictures from that era. If you're a collector and you're looking to get more Shaw Brothers stuff, this is a good way to go. If you're looking for entry-level Shaw Brothers, I wouldn't say that any of these are entry, but if you want to look at something that's a little more in the classic genre of it, To Kill a Mastermind is the one that's probably going to be appealing the most to non-super fans already. So you might want to check that out. If you're unsure, you can look up trailers on YouTube for each one of these. And there's plenty of websites out there where people are talking about it, because Shaw Brothers has quite the following. It's not just a cult following. It's a thing into itself online. So hopefully we get to see more of these from 88 Films. They've done a good job so far releasing these. And I'm happy to say that there's, you know, not a dud in any of these that they've released, and hopefully we can see more in the future.
Hey guys, this is Mike the Birdman here. I'm here to talk about something we got a chance to take an early look at, but is going to be released like literally this week. And I'm going to be talking about the 2024 edition of the Player's Handbook from Dungeons & Dragons. But one thing I do have to note, I have not had a chance to play test this yet, simply because, well, I don't have a group that is willing to do this just yet, because obviously not everybody has the book. However, you can pre-order the book on D&D Beyond, and depending on your right subscription level, you should have access to it, but it will be available, I believe, on September 17th is when I believe the book hits mass retail. So I've had a chance to go through this, and I've had a chance to listen to some other people chat about this, and I'm kind of comparing my own thoughts with it. So the 2024 Player's Handbook, is it compatible with other supplements in the game? And the short answer is yes. Will you have to do some tweaking in certain areas? Yes. Making characters is still remarkably easy. I know in D&D Beyond, they've already started to update some things so you can switch between the new content and what's now considered legacy content in 2014. And they have made the game overall, I would say, a lot more powerful. Like, you can get feats really easy from your background, ability score increases, that sort of thing. So I feel like the power creep in this game is going to be pretty significant, and it'll be really interesting once some of the other big YouTubers like D&D Shorts, the Dungeon Dudes, WebTM, taking 20 start to do their combo videos and how to build the most optimized characters as things proceed forward. Although some classes have gotten buffs, like I think the monk is one of my favorite classes, and holy crap, if you know how to build a monk in this game, you're basically Goku, or like Avatar the Last Airbender. You're basically Aang, and you can like grapple people in ridiculous ways, and with the right amount of feats, they're not touching you, homie. You would be virtually nigh invincible in the right situations. Druid's got a pretty significant overhaul as well. We're not just necessarily a mountain of hit points now, which I guess kind of makes a lot of sense, because if you could shift into something that had 100 and something hit points at a really low level, why wouldn't you? So they've kind of reworked how that works, but they've also changed up how certain druid subclasses work, so you can change what spells and stuff you have access to every day. And again, I do think that's pretty cool. I do like how they've kind of laid out some of the artwork on this. Like, this book has an amazingly cool layout when it comes to art. Like, each class is getting a bunch of really cool artwork. I particularly like, I think it's the assassin subclass from the rogue, looks really awesome. The wizard, just, it's really kind of cool. Mechanically, I wonder how long this game's going to take to bring people over, because I kind of wish there was a starter set that had come out alongside with this, just to give people a way to ease into this, or maybe have the books come out a little bit closer together. Like, I know this book comes out now. We're going to have the Dungeon Master's Guide in, I think, November, and we get the Monster Manual very early next year, like February. And I kind of wish we had all three toolkits to play around with, just to see how everything's going to get, you know, mixed together and interact, though. Because, like I said, I do like some of the rules that have been changed here, and I kind of wonder if they've taken some inspiration from, you know, just general player feedback and playtesting, but also if they've taken some inspiration from sources like, say, Baldur's Gate 3, which really brought a lot of new people into the D&D realm, so to speak, and really gave them people an idea, like, how does this work? I know a lot of the spell combos that I used to work probably won't anymore. Like, you're basically limited to, I think it's one spell per action, but there are ways to take advantage of that. Like, I know there was one video on D&D Shorts where they talked about there's a high-level cleric ability, which normally allows you to cast the spell, but it takes 24 hours. But there is a weird loophole where you can technically cast it for free, and it grants all the monsters vulnerability to whatever you want. So, again, no rule system is perfect. There's only always going to be somebody who knows how to get around that. And obviously the 2014 edition of the game was no different, and it'll be no different in this edition of the game. I wonder what the player adoption rate is going to be, because I've never been, in a professional sense, in a reviewer standpoint, to be in a transition point between different editions of the game. My closest example I can think of is maybe when I was playing Pathfinder and then looking over at Pathfinder 2.0, which I don't love. I don't mind it, but I don't love it. And now that I work on a TTRPG going from first edition to second edition, I do see some improvements there, but it's a learning curve. So I think if you have a very patient dungeon master who's willing to learn with you, I think this can be a really smooth transition for you. I think as time goes on, you're going to see the adoption rate of this go up. And again, once you start seeing more of the bigger YouTubers coming out with their compilation videos talking about class builds and whatnot, I think the big channels to watch, I think, especially for something like this, because I know they do extensive coverage, is the Dungeon Dudes. I definitely recommend. But I also like watching channels like D&D Shorts, which give you more of the game-breaking mechanics, but also show you how it can be a lot of fun if you're willing to do some of the more unusual things here. So my opinion of this so far is I like the base of what I'm seeing. And again, with some of the changes they've made, like I said, the monk class feels especially fun in this. Like I said, if you have the right combo of feats and ability score increases with the right subclass, this could be a lot of stupid fun. And that's ultimately why we play Dungeons & Dragons, right? It's to play a game where it's the power fantasy, it's stupid fun, we get to have adventures with our friends and family, and we get to tell some pretty epic tales with that along the way. And I do like some of the spell changes that have been made too in here. Like, a lot of the spells, you know, may have been slightly changed or tweaked from the 2014 edition, and that is reflected in D&D Beyond, which I think is a really nice choice. You get to see legacy and current content as well. So do I recommend the Dungeons & Dragons 2024 Player's Handbook? I'm going to give it a cautious yes, because I want to know, basically the ultimate decision for you to pick this up will be, what is your group going to vastly adopt? And highly recommend, ask around, see what people think. But if you're a new player to Dungeons & Dragons, and if this is going to be your gateway, then yes, this is a really good pickup for you. It has changed the rules. It's a little bit simplified in some ways, and it's going to streamline a lot of play, so you're not necessarily getting bogged down and stuff. For older players or people who already have an established group, you're going to have a conversation among yourselves. Are we going to upgrade to the new edition? Because basically all the content that's going to be coming out from here on out is going to be made with this handbook in mind. So as we move forward to 2024 into 2025, that's something we're going to have to keep in mind as we move forward into this awesome roleplay game hobby that we currently play. So anyway, guys, yeah, I'll probably have more deeper thoughts on this once I have a chance to playtest it. I know I am waiting on the alternate cover copy of this to come my way sometime in the near future. And as far as I know, I'm getting the Dungeon Master's Guide and I'm getting the Monster Manual as well from Hasbro and Wizards of the Coast. So I will have my thoughts on those whenever they arrive. So guys, that's going to do it from this Dungeon Master. I've been Mike the Birdman, and let's move on to our next review.
Basically, he was a geek, sir.
Leave me alone, geek boy.
Holy shit, you geeks are badass.
Alex, the producer here, and I have a game from Sega of America. They sent over Demon Slayer Kimetsu no Yaiba Sweep the Board for review on PlayStation 4/PS5. This is, for lack of a better term, a Mario Party style game, based obviously within the Demon Slayer world. Now, you are expected to know what Demon Slayer is. I think if you're going to purchase this or you're interested in it, you likely already do know a lot or have watched everything. And it takes place, basically, you're just on a board, or there's five different boards you can play on, and they have some slightly different rules, and you work your way around the board. The goal is to make your way to a specific spot on the board that will then grant you a certain amount of points. It switches to a night cycle where the demons come out and you have to make your way to fight the demon, and you have to work together with either co-op players online, or it has computer players playing with you if you're not playing online that fill the gap. It's a pretty simple premise. There's tons of little mini games, like from like ping pong to like jumping rope and a bunch of other stuff on here. and that you can master, you can get trophies, all that fun stuff. It's everything you think of when you think of like a Mario Party type of game. Now, it's not the deepest game possible, but I had a lot of fun with it. I played enough that I got about, 80% of the trophies. I didn't get absolutely everything because I didn't master every single mini game. But I even played online a fair bit. And at first I thought, is there going to be enough people playing? And it turns out, it's a global thing. It seems to connect to pretty much anybody. I was playing with people in Japan. I was playing with people in North America. And we would play some rounds together. And it's pretty fun. You can set the rounds anywhere from, five round short game to a 30 round game. I did one 30 round game. That took a long time to beat. But you can change the difficulty of all of the different CPU players when you're playing with them. There's a decent variety of demons to beat up. Good graphics. It's got all the voice acting from the show. Like, they got the American voice actors to dub the voices in English, which is great. Not a lot of games do that when they do the anime adaptations. Very happy with that. I've recently caught up on the show. I think it's just finished its original run, and now we're just waiting on three, I think it's theatrical movies coming out that are going to be finishing off the show in its entirety. So it's a good time that it's come out. It's got a price point in Canada of, actually in the States, of $59.99. If it's worth it, it's going to depend on how much of a fan of the show you are. If you're somebody who knows nothing of the show, you're not interested in the show, you're probably not going to find value in that unless it drops down to about half that price or something during, and you want just a fun party game to play. If you're somebody who is a big fan of the Mario Party style games and you want something different on the PlayStation, you'll like this for sure. If you're a fan of the series, you're going to love it. So I do think that there's value in it in its current price point. There are going to be some people, admittedly, that we'll find it shallow or find it going, I don't get it. To those people, I say you're probably not somebody who is the target audience for this, being it's made specifically for fans of the show. But I do think that once you start playing it, if you played it with somebody who is a fan, it might get you into the show, and then you'll end up wanting to play it even more and have a lot more fun with it in that way. Well worth checking out. If you're unsure, watch a trailer, watch some videos of it on YouTube, and then maybe give Demon Slayer Sweep the Board a try.
Hey, motherfuckers!
According to this, it could be an acute subdural hematoma.
Great, get in there and operate, Dr. Google.
It's a fungus, they think. Benign fungus.
Great title for your memoir.
Come all the way up.
Fuck you.
Come all the way up. I am surrounded by snakes and fucking morons!
He did not fire me. He said it was just going to take a little longer.
What I think he meant to say was that he wished that mom gave birth to a can opener, because at least then it would be useful.
Hey guys, what's going on? This is Mike the Birdman here. I'm here taking a look at something we got sent from Warner Brothers Home Entertainment. I'm talking about the Blu-ray release of Succession, the complete series. Deja Vu. I actually reviewed this last year, I want to say, when it was released on DVD. So I talked about the basically the power, the politics, the money that basically Logan Roy, Brian Cox's character with his amazingly dysfunctional family. Amazing cast in this show. Kieran Culkin, standout, love that guy. And like, it's a quirky dramedy, I would say, though erring more on the drama side. There are some funny moments in it, but it's basically, just watching this family continually stabbing each other in the back. I'm better than you. Some really amazingly well-written dialogue scenes. Some funny compilations that are up on YouTube. You probably heard some of that during the introduction there. And just over the top, it's ridiculous. Though not my favorite HBO show I've ever seen. This show just didn't grab me in particular. I don't know. This show just, it isn't my bag. However, that being said, this show has won countless Emmys. It's talked about in a number of different, television critic circles. I know a lot of people like this sort of thing, and I love Brian Cox. I've seen him in so many movies over the years, though most of my nerdy friends will say, oh yeah, that's General Stryker from X-Men 2 United, and you would be correct. And Kieran Culkin, oh yeah, that's the guy from Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, you would be correct. And I don't know. I mean, it's kind of cool how, like, you do have the complete series. It's, like, just shy of 40. You do get, like, 2 hours of, like, bonus content, which, like, goes into some of the actors' experiences, episode breakdowns, character recaps. The standard stuff you start to come to expect from these big releases of television shows. One thing that I think strikes this down, in my opinion, is I can't stand the packaging. It's the tall package where the discs are stacked one on top of each other, and I'm always afraid the discs are gonna get scratched if they move the wrong way, or if I just happen to like bump it or something and one of my discs gets knocked loose. I'm just not a fan of that style of packaging, but I feel like this is priced at a position where you can easily get everything in the highest possible quality currently available. Why this isn't in 4K, I'm not 100% sure, but I'm sure that'll come out probably next year. And maybe they'll have like some extra bonus content, maybe like some extra deleted scenes or commentaries or something. That's pure speculation on my behalf. But I would love to see that, maybe a cast and crew reunion get together for like a coffee table talk or something like that. Because, you know, this show's going to be talked about for quite some time. But I just feel the packaging's kind of a weak point. Although you do get kind of a nice kind of slip cover. It would have been nice if it had some like embossing on it. If I did have to give a little bit of my marketing PR riz on that, I think that would be cool. But ultimately, if you want to check out Succession, the complete series, I would recommend watch a first episode on any available streaming service like HBO Max or Crave if you happen to be in Canada. See what you think, and if you like that, watch a couple clips on YouTube, and then yeah, if this is your bag and if you want to join this great multimedia empire and its ultimately amazingly messed up legacy of dysfunction, then you should probably check out Succession, the complete series. Once again, that comes to us from our friends over at Warner Brothers Home Entertainment. That is Succession, the complete series, available on Blu-ray.
All in favor of the vote of no confidence in Logan Roy?
Me. My hand is raised.
Oh, no shit, Judas. You better be smelling your fucking armpit, Romulus.
It's my fucking company.
You are a fucking nobody.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Fucking amateur hour at the fucking circus.
People come to us because we don't sell them on anything. No packet of fucking bleeding heart, United Nations, Volvo, gender bender horseshit.
Why can't he come to us?
Cameo the Smiling Man, Famicom Detective Club, is the newest game in the Adventure series from Nintendo themselves. They provided a review copy for us to check out, and I was pretty intrigued going in because I got the Famicom Detective Club collection last time they released that. Well, I guess technically it was the first time in North America was the remakes that they made for the Nintendo Switch. That sort of came out of nowhere when they did, and this was the sequel. You know, it makes sense now that they did the remaster of the old ones, because it's like, oh, obviously they were working on this, but nobody thought that that's what they were doing. And when this trailer showed up, the little tease for Emeo, and people were like, what the heck is this? Is it a mature horror game? Is it, you know, what do they have that, you know, in their repertoire that they could be going back to? And people didn't really expect that it was going to be Emeo the Smiling Man. But okay. So what we have here is a game in the same engine, better graphics overall. I can't really review too much because it's going to be hinged on the story and the immersive nature of it. I had a good time playing it. The graphics are well done. Audio and atmosphere is good. It's clearly a mature team that put this together. If you've liked the previous Famicom Detective Club games, when they put that out, what was it, year or two more ago? It's hard to tell anymore. But this is not going to be for absolutely every Nintendo fan out there. Obviously, it's M-rated. There's mature themes involved, and it is much more like Nintendo is finally dipping their toes back into adventure, visual novel, detective-style games that have been popular with a very niche group on the side for many, many years. And you've got other companies, specifically like P-Cube, that has published and developed a bunch of them, as well as in the West here, Axis Games does most of the translations. Pretty much on the Switch, they're quite popular with, again, a very select group of people, and they're very fairly cheap to make compared to other games. But if you go looking for other games in the style, it's mostly published by Axis Games, and there's usually like seven of these things a year put out in different genres, usually tending to go towards the more women demographic. Either they're romance related or there's murder detective-y type stuff, but this is sort of a broader appeal than that, and you can see that Nintendo had seen how popular a lot of those games had become, again, especially in the West, being translated by third parties, and they went, hey, let's capitalize on that, and let's put out our own stuff. And that's what we got here. Now, this game can be purchased for $65 Canadian dollars physically, or you can get it for the same price digitally. And that might be a bit of a sticking point for some people. I think, personally, it's fully worth the full price of what they're asking. It's not the $79 or $89 that you see with AA and AAA titles nowadays from pretty much every company. Some people might say, oh, well, because I think 64 Canadian, that's the equivalent of like 40 American right now, or 44, whatever. I don't know what the exact exchange rate is when it comes to games, but that's sort of in that price point. And I feel like some people are like, well, this should be like a $30 game. You might be able to find it on sale at some point for that, but the polish that was put into this release and the fact that it's an IP that has been underserved and a genre that's been underserved for many years, it doesn't surprise me of the price point they're going for. I think it's well worth the value. There is a demo available for anybody that wants to try it, and I highly recommend you try that first, because that way you don't have, you know, any worry about purchasing, or you if you're worried you might have like buyer's remorse or something, don't. I think most people like this, as long as you know what you're getting yourself into. But just in case you're not, check out the demo. Anybody can check it out. It's well worth it. It might be something that for those out there that are more, if you like playing RPGs and you're more into the story than any combat, and you're like, well, maybe I could have more just pure story, or if you like walking simulators that maybe are usually a little more in depth, like Life is Strange, that sort of stuff, but you're like, you know what, I want something that's just more like a story, an investigative tale where I have interactivity, but it's not quite fully immersive like that. That's what you get here, and that might be something that people might want to pick up come the holiday season, either as a stocking stuffer or as a little extra present that you might not expect. And I think Emio the Smiling Man is a point in the right direction for Nintendo doing a little more diversity in the types of games that they put out, and I hope to see plenty more in the future, either from this series or from maybe new series that they produce in the same way.
This is a fair request, and I promise I will not judge any person only as a teenager, and that this is no more right than saying all teenagers are drunken dope addicts or glue sniffers.
Kong Tidal Wave is here with reinforcements, sir, and in the nick of time. Your victory is assured with Tidal Wave's experience in other battles, Megatron. In fact, he came directly here from the planet Dibola, where he led his Decepticon troops to victory.
Hey guys, this is Mike the Birdman here. I'm here to talk to you about one of the latest products we got for review from our friends over at Hasbro. And I'm going to be talking about the Transformers Legacy United Titan Class Tidal Wave. As you guys know, I love Transformers, and I especially love anything in the Titan class, because when I was a kid, one of the first Transformers I ever got was Metroplex, and I've pretty much been in love with the big giant robot scale pretty much forever. And then a number of years ago, Hasbro gave me Metroplex to review from the Generations line, and we reviewed Guardian Robot a while ago, probably during the pandemic, if I remember correctly. So when Hasbro sent over Tidal Wave, this is a very new character to me, because I never got into the Energon, Armada, Cybertron cartoons when I was a kid. However, though, that being said, I have been picking up some of these toys on my own. Like, I was fortunate enough to get gifted Armada Megatron this year, which actually combines with Tidal Wave to form Burning Megatron. I'll get to that in just a minute. But I also got the Armada Optimus Prime, which is probably one of the greatest figures I've ever had a chance to lay my hands on. But like, hot shot. I know there's a new Armada Wheeljack that just got announced at Hasbro's PulseCon recently. And there's just a lot of really cool characters in the Energon universe that I really want to get into. So, getting Tidal Wave, he is a Titan-class Transformer, which means he turns into a battleship, he turns into a base, and he turns into a robot. But one of the coolest things about this is he has a combined mode with the aforementioned Armada Megatron to form Burning Megatron. So to take advantage of that Evo Fusion gimmick, he can turn into his form from the aforementioned cartoon and become this more empowered version of Megatron, which has Tidal Wave's Dark Fleet abilities kind of flowing through him. So he gets like these leg risers, he gets weapons on either side of his arms, and he gets a jetpack. So now it fixes some of the flaws that were inherent to the original Armada Megatron figure and now gives him a much larger stature, and just it makes him look like a better version of the older toy that came out in the early 2000s. Tidal Wave himself, I think, is a pretty cool Transformer. And the fact that he does so much, I think his robot mode is the weakest part. And that's only because I think his Dark Fleet components do a lot of the heavy lifting. He can form into three different things. When you form him into this ultimate battleship mode, that's pretty kick-ass. I mean, I really wish I had a place to display all these Titan-class figures in their base modes, because Tidal Wave would look pretty kick-ass next to Scorponok and Triptychon, which are also in that Titan-class scale. But just the fact that this figure is able to combine with a Voyager-class figure, which I know a lot of people were speculating for a long time, how's this even going to work? It does work surprisingly well. The transformation is relatively easy to pull off between everything. And even when you have the Burning Megatron components taken off of Tidal Wave, he does display pretty good in robot mode, as he doesn't lose a whole lot other than some parts off his legs and some parts off of his arm. Although he does have a big hollow point in his back, which would be nice if there was like a gap filler, but I would imagine some third-party companies probably already come up with a solution to that anyway. But if you're viewing him from the back, it doesn't really matter. Now, this is an expensive figure, but I have seen sales going on recently. So if you don't have to pay full retail for this figure, I'm going to say it's definitely worth picking up, especially if you have that Armada Megatron, because you are getting that added play function to it. But just on its own, Tidal Wave, it's a very cool figure. I do like everything that it does, the fact that it has multiple modes. You can do all these like crazy combinations of weapons. If I did have one complaint, it would have been nice if his Minicon had come with him, which I think the Minicon was called Thrust. However, when you put this guy into base mode and you start bringing out some of those legacy core class figures, then you've got some pretty cool Minicon-esque action kind of going on, and I think that's pretty cool. So overall, I'm going to give Tidal Wave, yes, you should pick it up, but wait for a sale. Even if you can save like 20 or 30 bucks off this, I really think it's worth it. Do I think it's the strongest Titan class? No, but I've got different opinions on that the most. I think the strongest Titan that I've had the most fun with from a mold standpoint is Triptychon, and then probably I'd say Scorponok. So I do tend to lean towards the Decepticon Titans as opposed to the Autobot ones, but it wouldn't surprise me if Tidal Wave gets recolored into his other. I think he's still called Tidal Wave, but he's more green with these like Energon scars he gets on his legs. So it wouldn't surprise me if that becomes like a Hasbro Pulse exclusive at some point down the line. But no, seriously, check this figure out. If you are a big fan of Armada, Cybertron, and Energon in general, I think this figure's worth adding to your collection. For everybody else, if you like the bigger Transformers, wait for a sale, wait for the price to get right into the right range for you, and I think you're going to be impressed with this Decepticon Titan as he lords over the battlefield with his Dark Fleet. And since he kind of talks like a Pokemon, Tidal Wave! It's pretty cool. Anyway, guys, that's all I got today, and be sure to check this out at your local toy retailers or online.
The tide has turned in your favor, Megatron. and soon you shall rule the universe.
Ah, at long last.
By the way, we've reserved the final blow for you, sir. Tidal wave, begin the final phase.
Transform!
Mill Creek Entertainment has sent over a new collection in their Icons Unearthed series. We talked about the Star Wars one a little while ago, and earlier in the summer, I believe. And now we have Icons Unearthed Fast and the Furious. It's a 6-part documentary series, which has exclusive interviews with Tyrese Gibson, T.I., Lucas Black, amongst many more people. And it is a interesting set. If you're a big fan, like I'm a big fan, it's not even like a guilty pleasure of the franchise. I hated the first three movies when they came out. I couldn't stand them. And then they sort of grew on me because my brother made me watch the fourth film after he said, they changed it. It's now a heist movie. And then I watched the fourth and fifth with him. And then since then, six, seven, eight, nine, and ten are with on theaters, as well as the spinoff Hobbs and Shaw, and had a raucous good time. And what this is it's a documentary that follows the creation of the franchise based on the producers reading an article that talked about illegal racing that was happening across America, and then it shows a just love letter to the cars, to racing, to everything, to production of the film in general. And it's a well put together documentary. If you saw or heard us talk about the previous Icons Unearthed, you know what you're in for. It is 264 minutes, it's spread over two discs, and it is documentary quality in that it's not like going to blow you away visually, but it's stereo audio, video looks fine. Better than what you'd see if you were streaming, because obviously it's full 1080p, no bandwidth constrictions there when it comes to bitrate. And interestingly enough, compared to any other format you're going to see online when it comes to streaming or anywhere else, it also has over 5 hours of bonus full interviews with all the different actors from the films that they use snippets from within the documentary. But this way you get to see them all uncut, full interviews with each. And this is pretty much the only way you're going to be able to watch that. It's good, solid. If you're a fan of the series, you might want it. If you're a fan of the documentary series itself, you'll probably want it as well. Casual fans, probably not. But I do think that most people that are fans, in quotes, of Fast and Furious are pretty rabid about it, and I think you'd be interested in picking this up. It has an MSRP of $40 US. You're probably going to find it cheaper either on Dip Discount or on Amazon or maybe Walmart. And at $40, it is asking a bit for some people to get into it unless you're already a big super fan. But if you can find it on sale, I think it's worth it. If you're a super fan, you'll be able to pick it up full price and probably absorb it really right away. And I do think you're getting a pretty good bang for your buck because it is a pretty comprehensive documentary.
Do you have any hobbies?
I collect spores, molds, and fungus.
Hold that thought. It's crapper time.
Hey guys, this is Mike the Birdman here, here to talk to you about one of the latest releases from Warner Brothers Home Entertainment. I'm going to be talking about the Season 1 Blu-ray of Vikings Valhalla, which is the next entry in the Vikings series. And while I've actually never really gotten into the Vikings television show, this kind of piqued my attention. I mean, one of my favorite video games from the last couple of years was the Assassin's Creed game that, well, involved Vikings. And believe me, I was awesome in that game. Thoroughly recommend it and thoroughly enjoy that one. The Vikings television show just kind of slipped under my radar, but this one seemed pretty accessible, as it happens, I think, like 100 years after the end of the last one, and basically involves war with England and Norway, and like betrayals, people getting stabbed, shield maidens, all sorts of crazy Viking stuff. And honestly, it's pretty cool. And they squeeze all that in 8 episodes. So this is a series you could literally binge over like a weekend. And I think you're going to have a pretty bloody good time. And hey, who doesn't enjoy wanton violence with medieval weaponry? I mean, you got short axes, bows, swords, spears, axes. If you can't tell, I play a lot of Dungeons & Dragons, and this definitely scratches that itch without having to go into all sorts of weirdness with, like, beholders and liches and everything. That's not to say there isn't a supernatural element to this series at times, especially with, I think, the Seer, I think the character's called. But still, I thoroughly enjoyed this series. To talk about the Blu-ray a little bit, I think its weakest point, and I think this really kind of hurts it, is there isn't anything comprehensive in ways of special features. So I'm kind of hoping when the third and final season is eventually released on Blu-ray, we get a box set that actually gives us a lot of special features. It would be neat to see a documentary. It would be neat to hear some historians. It would be really cool to hear from some of the actors and stuff like that. Commentaries. Because, like, it's not like this show doesn't have a fairly big push behind it. Like, one of the executive producers is Jeb Stuart. He's the guy who did The Fugitive and Die Hard. And, you know, like, there's a lot of really big name stars in this. Like, there's Sam Corlett as Leif Erikson, Frida Gustafsson as Freydis Eriksdotter, and, like, just a lot of people that I recognize from, like, other projects overseas, I, like, recognize in this. So, again, I really wish whenever Netflix, because this was a Netflix thing, I really wish they would do extra things like this, because I really think it would add a much added value to it. But that being said, we are in the era of streaming media, so it's always nice to have physical. But you can always check this out on the streaming services as well. But I know a lot of people want to own their own media and stuff like that. And I think that's the real advantage to owning any of these Blu-rays, is you own it forever. And hopefully it's a good pressing, so you don't have to worry about disc rot sometime down the road, which has happened with some older DVDs and even some Blu-rays, I've heard. So do I recommend season one of Vikings Valhalla? Yeah. It's pretty cool, and it's pretty short, which the thing that I like about it is it's bingeable content that you can watch and enjoy, and if you want to check out the rest of the series, well, you got Netflix right there. So, hey, I really think you should check this series out. If you enjoy watching Vikings go to war with the Saxons, if you enjoy that high age of power, primal, personified, when, like, you know, men had ridiculously long beards and women were awesome shield maidens and Valkyries and all that sort of crazy cool shit that Dungeons and Dragons conjures, then this you should probably check out. Once again, that is Vikings Valhalla Season 1, currently available on Blu-ray from our friends over at Warner Brothers Home Entertainment.
Alex here, and I've got a different kind of review or impressions for you, and that is because we haven't usually covered a ton of PC-related items. Like, we do cover some hardware, some usually like audio, video equipment, that sort of stuff, but we haven't really done a lot of nitty-gritty building PC components style of recordings, and that's going to be a little different going into the fall. We're sort of in a process of doing an upgrade, because the last major upgrade that Birdman and I did to any of our studio equipment when it came to either recording equipment, media consumption, media creation, or gaming or anything related was back in 2019. We did stuff before the pandemic, and luckily, you know, it served us plenty throughout, and we both ended up getting the same hardware so that we could sort of be at parity when it came to reviews. We did not get like top tier gaming machines at the time. We were like, let's get some gaming computers that can do 1080p gaming at high. That was the goal, because we mostly do hardware reviews when it comes to like individual items that aren't PC related, and when it came to games, we usually did things on console. We're still primarily a console review company, but when it comes to PC stuff, Ken has joined and has done a lot, and now I've upgraded my PC, or I've done some Frankenstein stuff so I can do some more PC reviews. That's going to change even more in the future as we do, you know, a wider variety of PC review stuff. So I had already been thinking, hey, this stuff's long in the tooth. We're, you know, at the 5-year point. It is now time to start upgrading. Birdman's is going to come later, but I might use something that we received here for review on his equipment as well. But just, you know, a preface that we're going to be doing some upgrades over the next month or two, probably some stuff after Christmas, because some stuff we've sort of been holding off upgrading because there's been a whole debacle when it comes to the last two generations of Intel CPUs, which is something I was going to need to upgrade. And the same with AMD's recent launch. There's been some issues with it. And it's like, oh man, we were planning to do this big upgrade series, and it's kind of shook us a little bit. So we had, for our studio PCs, Ryzen 3600s, which were still, you know, a lot of people still use them. And they were pretty much like the best bang for the buck when we got the stuff put together. And since then, we've upgraded. Like, I think Birdman had 16 gigs of RAM. I had 8 gigs because I didn't think I needed quite as much. I've now got 32 gigs of RAM already, and I did that upgrade about a year ago. So that helped a fair bit. We've had SSDs, all that. Video cards, we had Radeon 5500 XTs. Which, again, good 1080p card, pretty good. Like, you know, not entry level, just one step up. And they were specifically the 8-gig cards, the better, in quotes, of those cards. And they held up pretty well. They weren't great for media consumption or anything. So I had previously switched to using an Intel Arc A380, which is a lateral move because performance-wise, it's roughly the same, maybe even a little bit worse on paper. But it did a ton better when it came to video decoding, encoding, all that stuff that I'm more into when it comes to my style of media consumption. Now, fast forward a little bit, and we're getting ready to upgrade. I was able to come across a RTX 3080 Ti, something normally out of my price range significantly because of just the price of even aftermarket GPUs, both Birdman and I being people that are disabled on disability support. You know, it's way beyond the price range of what we can normally do. My brother, though, had upgraded because through his work, what he required was something more powerful. He's got a 4090, and he had a 3080 Ti before, and he's like, I could sell this for like double or triple what I'm going to give it to you, but he's like, I got to make some money back. He goes, if you could cover the cost of resurfacing my driveway, which at the time he got a quote on it was $250. He goes, if you can come up with that money, you pay me when you can. I didn't pay it up front. So over the course of 2 or 3 months, I put together a little bit extra from my disability money. And I was like, okay, I can cover that. And he goes, okay. So I ended up with that. And it turns out I'm probably going to need a CPU upgrade, a case upgrade, all this stuff. And we'll get to that because that stuff's coming too. But it was a bunch of interesting things that were happening where I'm like, I'm crowding this GPU and all this. And I went, oh, I'm going to need to probably reflow and rechange all of my thermal paste, thermal grease, you know, thermal compound for all the computers because I haven't touched any of that stuff in 5 years or more in the bedroom PC that's the media consumption PC, as well as the living room PC, which was the podcast production PC. And then obviously family members as well, same thing. You know, I have parents that are in their mid to late 60s. They aren't touching computers themselves, like when it comes to doing any upgrades or maintenance on it, other than, you know, cleaning them out, air dusting, that sort of stuff. And I went, wait a minute, they're using hand-me-downs from me and my brother, and those are even older in some cases. They're 6 years old, 7 years old. So we had to make some changes. And I went, well, if I'm going to do this stuff just to make sure that they're still working, the computers run fine, they run a little warm, I'm going to have to end up getting some thermal compound or something for them. And that's when an opportunity came up where I was contacted and they said, hey, you know, this company Thermal Hero, based out of Germany and designs all the products in Germany, said, hey, would you like to try and sample some of our products? Are you planning to do any PC builds or anything like that? And I went, you know what? Timing wise, absolutely. So they said, hey, we'll send you a bunch of stuff. Check it out. Do it in your build. You know, do a review. Let us know what you think. And I said, okay, you know, we're not paid for this review. It's not a sponsored spot or anything. They just said, hey, would you like to try it? And I went, yes. So they sent over a bunch of products I'm going to use over the course of the next little bit on a few different projects. But I'll mention what each product is. They sent over three traditional thermal, paste, thermal grease compound stuff. They have the Thermal Hero Neo, which is a high-performance thermal paste. The Thermal Hero Ultra, which is a more higher-end, you know, more thermal conductivity, or conductivity, sorry. And then they have a Quantum, which is their more even higher-end. The Neo is more of like what you'd find from, I guess, a lot of standard companies, is everybody has sort of a baseline good, you know, product that's better than whatever random cheap junk comes on your CPU cooler, or if you you know, or comes on the actual die of it when you buy a computer anyway. And what's interesting, though, is that they're saying on all the packaging for each of these is that they are designed for all CPUs, GPUs, overclocking, gaming, PlayStation, Xbox, and industrial application. So that gives me some ideas of things to do. I've got a launch PS5. I don't think I'm going to attempt anything on that, because with the PlayStation, it's got liquid metal, and that's beyond my capability to manage. But I also have a launch Xbox Series X and an Xbox Series S, and I am sure what I also have lying around is I have a PlayStation 3 Slim. And I'm like, you know what? I might actually... I'd never thought of changing it on there just because it's me. And I was like, you know what? That thing's like 15 years old. It's time to do something with it. So I'm going to end up using that. I'll probably come back and talk about that at some point. But first thing is first. I was like, I'm going to use the Neo, which is the sort of standard baseline one that they have, which is rated... there's a bunch of... For anybody that's non-technical, there's a bunch of specifications on the back of thermal conductivity, the density, thermal impedance, operating temperatures, viscosity. I'll say for most of us people that, like, I'm a pretty technically literate person, and especially when it comes to building PCs, I was A+ certified. I was worked as a tech for years. We didn't follow a lot of the individual specs there because we weren't usually big overclockers when I was working in the repair centers. But what we did always try to find was, you know, what was the operating temperature? And that's usually meant, like, when does it work best, you know, in the room temperature plus whatever is being put through it from the CPU itself. And one of the things that we always look for was the operating temperature. And, you know, it says it's good for, you know, minus 50 degrees to 220 degrees Celsius. And then I was like, oh, that's pretty standard. That's good. That's better than some of the cheaper stuff. And then, well, we look at the Ultra, and it's minus 50 to 300. And then you look at the Quantum, which is the highest end one, they're saying, which is for extreme, you know, and I'm assuming that's for people that are doing, like, overclocking on or messing around using, like, I don't know, Threadrippers and playing around with, like, really high core counts, that sort of stuff. And, you know, it says minus 75 up to 300. So it's, you know, it's pretty good range there. It's beyond what I would have expected. So I'm going to use, and actually have used, I should say this, the Neo, which is the sort of baseline of the ones I was sent. I used that to repaste or cleaned up the paste that was on my father's old PC, which is running an 8th gen, an 8th gen Intel i5 with a stock cooler from Acer, and it dropped the temperature when I was monitoring it by about 5 degrees. And I was like, ooh, so that pulp paste was not doing its job anymore. And, you know, this is without changing anything else in there. That was great. I have then gone forward, and the bedroom PC is the Ryzen 3600, which was the one that was we built, you know, 5 years ago. That has now, it had a all-in-one cooler, all-in-one water cooler that was, you know, I purchased when I got it, and it was a cheapy $60, $70 one. It had been doing its job. I, for that, ended up using the Ultra, which is the mid-range paste that they had here, and put that on, and it was pretty dry, the stuff that I had on the old, block that was on there. So I was like, ooh, it's a good thing I did that. And again, about 7 degrees cooler under load, which is pretty crazy. But you know, I'm actually happy with the old setup that I had, that how long it's worked. I'm gonna hold on to the Quantum, and that's because I'm thinking that is going to be something that either I work with my brother on one of his computers, because he's got the more higher end stuff. We'll see from there. And the other things that were sent that I had heard of but never actually used, because it's been a few years since I've been in the game as far as building on the regular basis, and that is thermal pads. You know, I've used obviously basic ones when it comes to like single board computers and that sort of stuff, when you're putting little heat sinks on like a Raspberry Pi. But I know that that's become a thing now, where you can get these high performance ones, where if you don't want to deal with the mess that you can potentially make of how much or how little you're supposed to use a thermal compound when you're putting on a CPU, you get people arguing back and forth. And to all that, you know, you can get a thermal pad that you can just snip to fit the right size that you need. And they sent over two. There's the Gamma series, which is a high performance, and a Neo series, which is thicker. And, you know, there's a little sticker they put in the front of it that says Neopad Series OC Edition. I'm assuming that's overclocker. And again, what's different here is it doesn't just say PlayStation. It says PS3, 4, and 5, Xbox, industrial applications, CPU, and GPU. So I'm thinking, I'm doing, so I do plan on doing a major upgrade to the gaming slash production computer. And I'll be talking about that, I believe, next week as we're doing an upgrade. And I'll be having a review of some other hardware that we were sent out. So this is sort of a larger picture we're doing here. But I do believe the one thing I'm going to do is I'm probably going to use one of these pads on the 3080 Ti that I have. My brother used that Ti. It was not overly heavily used. He had it in an external GPU case that would be used for work when he needed to do certain specific rendering. But it wasn't like overly used. But those things can run kind of warm. And by kind of warm, I mean, you know, the 30 and 40 series are warm. So I might use one of those on there. And I will get back and talk about that when I do that project over the next few weeks. And then the other will be used, obviously, when I put together a brand new CPU in that system. And again, more to come later on that, but that's just sort of what I wanted to mention is this is not a field of product that we generally have talked about in the past. And it's like, there's a lot of people that are thinking, do I need to get this paste? Do I need to do anything like that? If you've got an older computer, but you're not ready to upgrade to a brand new computer, one of the things you can do to get a little more life out of that computer or push it a little farther without thermal throttling, without slowing your CPU down when you're playing games or when you're doing other more intense tasks, is you might think, wait, if I've got like 4-year-old, 5-year-old, 6-year-old, even 7-year-old sometimes, thermal paste on my CPU between the heatsink, fan, or liquid cooler that you've got attached, that stuff does dry out and it becomes less conductive and it's less efficient. And a simple fix can be picking up a tube of the stuff or picking up one of the pads and just, you know, shutting down your computer, unhooking it, taking off the clamps, pulling off your block there, and then just removing the best you can, the dried up, gunked up paste, applying new paste or a pad, closing it, and you could get, you know, 2, 4, 6, 7, maybe even more degrees of cooler operation under load. And that will prevent the computer from slowing down once it's been turboing up. And you might be able to, you know, get better frame rates in games or consistently run longer or have more system stability overall. So I'll put links to this stuff in the description here. And, you know, thanks for Thermal Hero for sending this stuff over for us to check out. It is always nice to see, you know, a brand new product that I've not been exposed to before and that I think is actually going to help a lot of people save money that, you know, maybe are thinking of doing a full computer upgrade, but can maybe get by, you know, maybe even 6 months, a year or more longer now that money is so tight with everybody, with just applying some extra thermal paste or new thermal paste or a new thermal pad onto their existing system.
Those magnificent bastards!
Color me kooky, but something very odd is going on around here.
You're not allowed to talk anymore.
And that's going to do it for this first review show of the fall 2024 season. Again, guys, thank you for being so understanding, as it's not every week you're attacked by dogs, rabbit infections, sinus infections, and basically the Lord Cthulhu coming down to strike down upon thee from the dread city of Relay Under the Waves. So, that all being said, we got a lot of really cool, exciting stuff coming up for you in the next couple of weeks here on the show. I'm currently recording a bunch of loose cannons with our good friend from Do You Even Movie, David Double D Denoyer. It's weird. Now we have another Double D on this show. It's like our show just attracts them in a weird way.
The other has been replaced forever. Yeah. We shall never speak of him again unless he shows up here again.
Although, you know what's funny? I found out the original Double D, David Double D Dennis, is working at the University of Toronto, I want to say, and he's working on the video game restoration project to restore all these classic video games.
okay. which is incredibly cool. So I'm very proud of Dave for taking an interest in that. And I think that's a really cool student project from him. Other Twig alumni recently had a very big movie in theaters where he was the director of photography. And that was good old The Punk himself. So if you go see the movie In a Violent Nature, that's one of our guys, which I think is pretty cool.
I guess if you want to hear him, you just hear him whenever we have the classic intro.
Yeah, exactly. So that is Pierce doing that. So congratulations to him. And then finally, one of the original co-founders of the podcast recently did audio voiceover work for Star Wars Outlaws. He is the audio descriptive voice for Jabba the Hutt. So congratulations to Steve for doing that. That's a pretty big milestone in your career. And hey, good for you, homie. So yeah, in terms of what's going to be coming up in the next, like I said, couple of weeks, like I said, I am recording a bunch of loose cannons with Dave. One you should hear fairly soon is we did release the first, or we watched the first three Trancers movies from Full Moon and Empire Pictures. We watched the first three. So The Adventures of Tim Thomerson as Jack Death, hunting Trancers all across time and space eventually. So me and Dave talked about the first three. We're also planning on doing something a little bit different. We want to talk about the Aladdin franchise because I've only seen the first one. I've never seen The Return of Jafar, or if I did, maybe once, and I've never seen King of Thieves. And then one
Jafar, we're planning... Jafar was like really super hyped when I, because I'm what, 4 or 5 years younger than you?
Yeah, I'm 43.
Okay, yeah, I'm 37. So I was the right age for them to super hype it for me. And I remember watching it, liking it. And then I remember the third movie coming out, King of Thieves, and not being the exact right age. I was still like, you know, the right age, but not the same. And going back later on and watching it, realizing that the third one is a lot better than Return of Jafar. And most of that is due to the fact that the dispute was over and they brought Robin Williams back.
Mm-hmm. So we're probably going to be doing that. We're waiting for the Crow reboot to get released on VOD. And then me and Dave are going to do a deep dive on that as sort of a follow-up to our Crow franchise show we did over the summer there, which I think will be kind of a neat follow-up because I saw the Crow reboot when it was on its opening weekend and initial thoughts, that was a mistake. But is there anything worth salvaging in that?
See, this is what I think happened. I think you saw the Crow and your body wanted to die so bad that you got an infection.
No, I got that from Borderlands.
See, that's the mistake. You watched Borderlands and The Crow, and then you wondered why you ended up in Emerge.
We're going to be doing that. I was talking, so it looks like this year's show for the Halloween special is going to be slightly changed. It's going to be me, Enrique, and James, and we're going to release that in late October. And the theme this year, to tell you guys right now, we're doing horror movie reimaginings and reboots that actually worked. So to look at some of the positivity that has actually emerged in this field, so we're not going to be talking about, say, Nightmare on Elm Street 2010, which I will admit had some good parts to it, but overall failed. We're not going to be talking about the Child's Play reboot from 2019, but we're going to be looking my two picks to give you preview now. I'm going to be talking about the Evil Dead remake from 2013, and then I'm going to be talking about the Hellraiser Hulu exclusive that came out in 2021, both of which upon initial viewing, I was a little lukewarm on, but now that time has given me the benefit of, say, evolving my critical eye, my opinions have actually drastically changed where I really enjoy these new entries in these franchises. And Evil Dead obviously had Evil Dead Rise that was a massive success. I think they're working on another one. And I think I think Hellraiser might even have some potential left in its tank as well. So I don't know what James and Enrique have picked just yet, but you can look forward to that after the 25th of October as we proceed in the spooky season. I know me and Alex and Aaron might be talking about some spooky sci-fi stuff. Maybe we can even find episodes of TNG and Stargate that have horror-like elements to it that might be kind of fun, actually.
Yeah, I'll investigate into something maybe we can watch. We'll see. Maybe we'll go back to like the 70s and see if there's like some sci-fi horror or something. something to that extent. Maybe even Roddenberry or somebody worked on something weird that we can look at.
I want to pitch to you.
I'm going to pitch to you what I think we should do with Aaron on the air, because I think, you know, it'll hold us to it.
Cool. Yeah,
I think we should go and talk to Aaron about picking some Twilight Zone and Night Gallery episodes.
Yes, I was hoping you would say this.
Because
I'm genuinely excited.
Because if we each pick, like if we did, let's say one, at least one episode or one podcast, maybe two, like if we each pick one classic Twilight Zone, and it can be, we'll expand it. We'll say you can pick from the original 50s, 60s show or from the 80s show, because a lot of the 80s ones were remakes of ones from that period.
Okay.
You know, we'll do that. And as much as I would say, like, we could do like Outer Limits, that's, you know, pure sci-fi a lot of the times. But, you know, I think for Halloween, Twilight Zone, and then maybe Night Gallery. We'll see. And if that, you know, we'll see how that works, because especially with the original Twilight Zone, they're half hour episodes, but they're those episodes where they're like a full 30 minutes because how television was back then, not like 22. Mm-hmm. So it's not too much for us to watch. It's basically like the equivalent of watching one full length movie. And then we can each, you know, pick one, and it can be either one that you know that you like, or
one that you've heard about.
You see that you go through the episode names and descriptions and you pick one.
That's okay.
And we'll, cause I mean, I have the original copies. It's available to stream online. A lot of the videos, like Twilight Zone, is available to like watch on YouTube, even if you don't care about the quality. I own like Twilight Zone on Blu-ray, so you and I are covered if I have to come over to your place and watch it with you, even. And I'm pretty sure Aaron will be able to do it. I think that'll be a fun one, because it's a little bit, it's a bit of in his wheelhouse of like 50s and 60s sci-fi, you know what I mean, like with his Earth versus Soup, which, speaking of, this week's episode is Warning from Space from 1956, and we'll have plenty more coming soon, so look out for that. And then it's a bit in our wheelhouse, it's a bit spooky, and it's also an easy watch where we don't have to worry about like sitting down to watch, you know, two movies or something that might be like 4 hours long. It's Twilight Zone. And if you don't like an episode, you can say I didn't like it and you move on to the next.
Yeah. Like I'm so into this idea. I was really hoping you would say Night Gallery and Twilight Zone. You've shown me some stuff from both franchises and I thought it was fucking awesome. So yeah, I am so into this. So guys, we got a lot of cool stuff coming up. I think we're recording a new Future Imperfect this Wednesday night, which will probably get released the following week. Don't want to say what those movies are just yet in case we have to change schedules, but I'm pretty sure we're on track to do that, providing they don't admit me. So on that note, yeah, there's a lot of cool stuff. By the way, I do want to make this announcement here. So I'm reworking my Patreon, which I think Alex has added my link to the website now. So going forward, I'm going to be releasing most of my role play episodes on my Patreon to try and drive people over there. And I'm going to put some stuff over here on the main feed. I'm also going to change how my pricing and tier works on my Patreon. I think I want to move it to a support me model rather than here, pay this much money, get this amount of content. Look, if you want to give me $2 or $5, that's great. That's what I'm looking for. I think it's a better way to do it because I want to encourage people. I don't want to paywall stuff because regardless, I'm still going to be throwing out content and it's going to take a long time to build a community. Like I've had you guys as a podcast audience since 2007. I can't expect people to just jump over to this new great thing. It's going to take some time and I'm fine with that. So I'd rather do it at a more gradual and humble pace. Like I'm not these YouTubers making or these Patreon people making 30,000-40,000 a year in Patreon or getting $1,500 a month in Patreon. And I'd be happy with $10.
And it's a big difference going from like it's generally the bigger Patreon launches are almost always people that were well established with audiences our size or larger in video first. Mm-hmm. It's a harder thing to have people navigate over when it's just audio, because we always know, like you can ask anybody, the biggest advertisement for Patreon or any other support type of thing has almost always been that YouTube itself.
Yeah, exactly.
People end up using YouTube to market their Patreon, which is not something that you do or that you would want to do.
Yeah, and I think it can be a lot more fun just because I can bring my friend Paul back on. We did 2 free episodes that will always be free. In fact, anything I release on my Patreon will always be free. And if you choose to support, awesome. And we talked about co-DMing. We talked about improv versus preparation in terms of dungeon mastering stuff. And I'm going to release my my player character sheet so you guys can see the characters that I'm playing in the campaigns right now, which I'm having a lot of fun with. I just invented this new Paladin Warlock combo, which is a lot of people call in the online communities the Witch Knight. And she hits like a truck. So it's a lot of fun playing with that. And I'm looking fun to sharing those character sheets with you sometime in the next few days. So anyway, guys, like I said, we are glad to be back for the fall 2024 season. We've got a lot of really cool ideas. Hopefully you enjoyed some of those reviews in our show. So this will inform some of your purchasing decisions. As always, keep an eye out for sales for like some of these things that we recommend. Always look for discounts. If you can find them, there's usually something on Amazon or Target or Walmart. There's always ways to find this stuff. So I guess for the 2024 beginning of the year, we have been
Alex, the producer.
I've been Mike, the Birdman, saying be excellent to each other. And we will see you guys later this week, right here on ThisWeekInGeek.net.
At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought.
Thanks for listening to this episode of This Week in Geek. Hungry for more? Check out our website at ThisWeekInGeek.net. You can subscribe to the podcast, browse our Twitter and Instagram, and leave your thoughts on today's topics. If you'd like to give us some feedback, send us an email at feedback@thisweekingeek.net. Tune in next time, and remember,
lower your shields and surrender your listenership.
We would be honored if you would join us.
Thank you for your cooperation. Good night.